Well, good evening, and welcome to the fourth event in this year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, Director of the Hall Centre, which organises the series. It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you Professor Nancy Cott from Harvard University, who is rightly recognised as a pioneer in the field of women's history. Tonight's event is co-sponsored by Kansas Public Radio and supported by the Distinguished Lectureship Program of the Organization of American Historians. Professor Cott will take questions after her talk, so please make your way to the microphones in each of the aisles. Following her talk this evening, she will sign copies of her books in the big 12 room, which is opposite this auditorium. There will also be a reception to which everyone is invited. A gentle reminder to check your cell phone is switched off or muted. The introduction to tonight's speaker will be made by Kim Warren, Assistant Professor of U.S. Women's History. Kim has a first degree from Yale, where she was first inspired by tonight's speaker, and MA and PhD degrees from Stanford University. Her research interests include the history of gender and race in African American and Native American education. Please welcome my good colleague, Professor Kim Warren.
Thank you, Victor. And thank you to Jason O'Brien and the Hall Center staff for inviting our guests to campus tonight. Colleagues, students, friends, thank you for joining us for the Hall Center's Humanities Lecture Series. I have the pleasure tonight of introducing historian Nancy Cott, someone whose teaching and scholarship have made national and international strides by placing gender at the center of our understanding of human experiences. To say that Nancy Cott is a pioneer in women's history is absolutely true. As a scholar, she has not only expanded the field of women's history, but she has enriched United States history as a whole by bringing to the fore the roles of women in the home, in work, in activism, in marriage, and in relationship to the state. In academic conversations, scholars often point to Professor Cott's book, The Bonds of Womanhood, Woman's Sphere in New England, 1780 to 1835, as her first groundbreaking contribution to historical research. The Bonds of Womanhood established the importance of private documents as sources for evidence and popularized an ideology of separate spheres. In 1977, when the book was published, she told her readers that understanding woman's sphere was important because, quote, for women who previously held no particular avenue of power of their own, no unique defense of their integrity and dignity, this represented an advance. For the past three decades, separate spheres has provided an intellectual framework for thinking about women's and men's experiences in economics, labor, society, and culture as distinctly gendered and sometimes competing, but always in relationship with each other and in relationship with power. She still maintains, and scores of other scholars agree with her, that viewing the past through a gendered lens is essential because it is the defining and the acting out of gender attributes and properties that will appear in every arena in which women and men live and interpret their lives. Nancy Cott's subsequent scholarship has taught us important lessons about how to conceive of the past. In articles and books, she has corrected the notion that feminist activities died after women got the vote in 1920. She has paid homage to women's historians of earlier generations, and she validated the radical efforts of suffrage activists who otherwise had been criticized by mainstream organizers. Over the past 30 years, she and her students, many of whom are scholars in their own right, have helped diversify women's history so that it is no longer simply about gender. Rather, race, education, region, class, sexuality, and religion have become integral components in understanding women's experiences. More recently, she has taken on the very timely topic of explaining the relationship of state and national governments to the public institution of marriage in her book, Public Vows, A History of Marriage in the Nation. Because of this work, when state legislatures and state supreme courts started making decisions about marriage amendments to their constitutions, they called upon Nancy Cott to teach them about the long history of marriage as a civil institution that has changed over time based on social and cultural conditions, but also economic and political factors. Her scholarship has been recognized by national and international foundations, including the Guggenheim Foundation, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and Fulbright. And her leadership and expertise have been called upon by several documentary filmmakers and societies, including the Organization of American Historians and the National Council of the American Studies Association. Presently, Nancy Cott is the Carl and Lily Pforzheimer Foundation Director of the Schlesinger Library on the History of Women in America at the Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study. And she is the Jonathan Trumbull Professor of American History at Harvard University. She took these positions in 2002 after a 26-year career at Yale University, where she was the Sterling Professor of History and American Studies and a founder of the Women's Studies Program in the late 1970s. As a university community, I think we owe much gratitude to Nancy Cott. She has influenced our work and our understanding of the past. She has provided models for forging new areas of research and teaching. And she has shown us how to move our studies out of the sometimes insular academic realm into larger political discussions. But I also know of four other ways that she has had an even more direct impact on KU. I probably should have mentioned right away that I take very special delight in introducing Nancy Cott tonight, because 15 years ago, it was her undergraduate American Women's History Survey course that changed my career path. At the time, I was an unhappy computer science major, eager to find a new field of study that would bring more meaning to my college education. As I listened to a semester's worth of lectures, each of which demonstrated women's significance and contributions, I knew that I had entered an intellectual world that I would never leave. I can say without a doubt that had I not walked into Nancy Cott's classroom, I would not be standing here today as a U.S. women's historian. And I know I'm not the only one in this room whose life and work have been directly influenced by tonight's guest. This year, Professor Tanya Hart arrived at KU after earning a PhD with Nancy Cott's direction, and she now teaches about African American women in the American Studies and Women's Studies programs. Professor Leslie Tuttle in the Department of History writes about marriage and the state in early modern France and has found Nancy Cott's work to be pathbreaking for her own. And back in the spring of 1973, when Anne Schofield, professor of American Studies and Women's Studies, taught her first women's history class, it was Nancy Cott's Root of Bitterness that she used in her course, as it was the premier volume on women's private documents. We all still use Professor Cott's scholarship to guide our teaching and research, and I'm sure that there are many others in this room who could say the same thing. In 1992, when I interviewed Nancy Cott for a magazine called The Yale Woman, which I actually found in my own little set of archives at home, I asked her to explain how the study of women impacts our understanding of history. And this is what she said. It might make history a lot more complicated. It doesn't simplify history, but I think it has to make what we know about the past a more accurate picture. Through her teaching and scholarship, Nancy Cott has helped us build a more accurate picture of the past in hopes that we can gain clarity for our future, and we thank her for that. Tonight, she will speak to us about grooming citizens, marriage, and civic status in U.S. history. Please warmly welcome Nancy Cott to our campus.
Thank you all very much, and thank you especially, Kim, for that really generous and gracious and exceedingly heartwarming introduction. Thank you. Well, I'm here to talk about the history of marriage, and I don't think I have to worry that this is a topic that will seem out of date or only in the past. Not only is it still very much a status that many of us venture into one time or another, but it's very much in the news these days. There's the recent decision of the New Jersey Supreme Court on the question of whether couples of the same sex deserve equal rights with couples who are of two different sexes when they go to marry. And there's also, I wonder if any of you noticed Sam Roberts' article in the New York Times, October 15th, that was entitled, "To Be Married Means to Be Outnumbered." This was the piece, the headline for the piece, displaying the new evidence from a current survey that the proportion of households in the United States that contain a married couple have dipped below one half of households. Only 49.7% of American households hold a married couple. And this is in part because of the aging of the American population and the number of households that are headed by widows or widowers, mostly widows. It's also because people are marrying later. But it's what's especially notable in people's minds is the proportion of unmarried heterosexual couple households that has zoomed up at a rate five times as fast as households overall. Of course, the number of same-sex couples cohabiting and seeking marriage has grown at even a faster rate. And now households hold many sorts of groups. They hold unrelated groups. They hold cohabitors. They hold multi-generational rather than couple-based households. And there are, of course, many single-person households and single adults raising children. Besides this, for every two new marriages that take place, there's one divorce. And another index that has raised a lot of eyebrows, if not alarm, is that at least one-third of births in the U.S. today take place outside of marriage. So the institution of marriage has clearly become very fraught. Most Americans, I think, would like to see marriage as a static institution. We're encouraged to think, and we're probably quite prone to believe, that marriage has been the same since time immemorial, as is frequently said. But the more complicated truth is that sanctioned forms of household and family formation by adults have varied hugely over place, culture, and time. It's simply not the case that marriage has been the same since time immemorial. But when Americans speak of marriage, mostly they mean a particular form of monogamy, the roots of which are Christian, and the form of which was created by Anglo-American law. In terms of human history, this is a quite recent form, really only concretized about 500 or 600 years ago. But this received institution of marriage, which is the institution familiar to us, is also complicated because it's double-sided in more than one way, or it could be said that it is a paradoxical institution in its very formation. And I'll mention several of the ways. First of all, strictly in legal terms, marriage is both a contract and a status, though these two, as legal terminologies, are distinct. They're almost opposites legally. But it's been this way, marriage has been this way, ever since it was regularized and codified in Europe between the 16th and 18th centuries, first codified by ecclesiastical and then by secular authorities. A contract is a matter of consent. It's joined by private agreement. No one contract need be exactly like another, since the parties themselves can decide what the contract is, what is its substance, its extent. A status, on the other hand, means a legal standing that's fixed by public authority, that attaches certain rights or limitations or duties to those in a defined group or class. So, for instance, a minor's, we talk about a minor's status as compared to an adult's, or a citizen's status as compared to a non-citizen's. Well, marriage has both these features of being a contract and a status. Two individuals consent to marry, and they thereby form a contract, but it leads them into a status relationship. So this means that when we talk about the contract of marriage, which you frequently do, it's no ordinary contract. The state is always a third party to that contract, along with the couple. It's the state that authorizes the marriage, that mandates its form and some of its terms, and that means that the couple is prevented from making the contract totally their own. The involvement of state authority also implies that the public supports that bond that the couple choose to make, that the public will enforce it and values it as something worthwhile to the community at large. The reason I called my book Public Vows is that I wanted to emphasize that the public is making a vow in supporting marriage at the same time that a couple publicly, necessarily publicly, takes their marriage vows. Now, a century or more ago, it was very obvious, it seemed very obvious to legislators and jurists and social commentators why marriage meant this government or state interposition. In their view, governments were created to institute social order, and what could be more disorderly than unconstrained sex, especially in non-contracepting populations, and haphazard transmission of private property. By stipulating monogamous marriage and setting up regulations for it, governments corralled both these areas of sex and property. And 100 years ago, 150 years ago, the notion that a government that cared about the public good would not regulate marriage was, and I quote, too absurd to require a word of refutation, end quote. This was a quote from the 19th century's most prominent legal treatise on domestic relations. But today, the public benefit of government involvement in marriage no longer goes without saying. And the premise that a marriage is a relationship that necessarily transcends the individual lives of partners is not so self-evident, nor is it self-evident justification for government to be involved. Questions arise about this, and arise in part because marriage is a doubled or paradoxical institution, and I'll mention some of the other ways. It is, of course, as the legal terminology suggests, it is both a private, intimate relationship and a public status that has to be validated by public witness and civil law. Marriage requires the state, but for most Americans, it also invokes religion. It is a civil right, the right to marry, but it's also understood by the majority of Americans as a sacred ceremony. Marriage ceremonies, most commonly in this country, take religious form. Spokespersons for various religions often try to impose their view of what marriage is or should be on the rest of the broader society. But from its very founding, in the United States, marriage has always been an institution authorized by the civil law. It's meant to serve the purposes of civil society. Each colony, state, and territory of the United States, as it came into being, set up marriage laws and regulations, and these laws or regulations were supreme over any religious views or practices of marriage. Yet, also, government rules on marriage have, for the most part, echoed and reinforced Christian dictates and have been all the more powerful because they do echo religious values. Still, in terms of the literal authority, the civic decision-making has remained paramount. And through much of American history, American legislators and jurists have not hesitated to exercise their own jurisdiction over marriage, even while they often cite rhetorically divine law or the law of nature as what has made them act. So governments at all levels in the United States have been concerned to encourage marriage and to regulate marriage because the institution sets rules for sexual behavior, it organizes households, and it figures quite largely in property ownership and inheritance. And those are all matters of civil society in which governments are highly interested. Marriage creates economic obligations between the parties through their mutual consent, and it binds them to support their dependents. Public authorities in the U.S. historically have relied on marriage as the principal vehicle for organizing economic sustenance to individuals, particularly those who are dependent, like the very young or the very old. And today, if we look across the industrialized world, the United States, more than any other industrial nation, channels its social benefits through the spousal relationship. I'm talking about things like Social Security or veterans benefits, tax breaks also, which in many European countries are directed immediately toward the individual. In the U.S., it tends to be funneled through the marital household or marital relationship. And state and federal recognition of marriage appears in many forms. We especially notice it in terms of immigration and citizenship, tax policy, property rules, but also benefits like veterans survivors benefits, Social Security benefits, intestate succession rights, jail visitation privileges for that matter. These things are extended to legally married spouses and not to other intimate partners or friends. At the state level is where marriage regulation is supposed to take place in the U.S., but government involvement in marriage has become, through the 20th century, so extensive that even in federal law, there are more than 1,000 places where benefits, or responsibilities, or rights are assigned based on marital status. And all of this state involvement expresses the fact that marriage has been and continues to be an institution of governance. It has been intended to serve public order. Yet, and here's another one of these paradoxes, marriage has equally served as a marker of individual freedom. Now, can one institution embody both governance and freedom, public and private, state and religion, status and contract? Marriage does. Legal marriage expresses individual freedoms by being based on free choice and voluntary consent. Mutual consent of the two parties, uncoerced consent, has been seen as essential to Christian marriage since its beginning, and that premise was incorporated into Anglo-American law. In the medieval church, a couple's agreement to marry, just that consent, made a valid marriage even if no ceremony whatsoever took place. And the abilities to give, the individual's ability to give that consent is the mark of the free person who has basic civil rights. This is a fact that is compellingly illustrated in American history by the history of slavery. Slaves had only informal unions. They may have had stable unions, they may have been loving in their commitment, but they could not marry legally. They were not able to do so because an individual slave did not have the capacity to give consent to the marriage contract. The master's power could always intercede and overcome slaves' intentions, and therefore no slave could validly consent to carry out marriage obligations. The ability to marry was the mark of a free person with civil rights. Building on this basic association between individual freedom and consent in marriage, during the 20th century, American courts have increasingly articulated the right to marry as a fundamental right. One example of this progress was in the 70s when the U.S. Supreme Court overturned state laws that prevented incarcerated felons from marrying. This was seen as an interference with their fundamental rights. And the Supreme Court has struck down laws that, and I quote from one of these decisions, attempt to interfere with the individual's freedom to make a decision as important as marriage, end quote. certain things about marriage, principles within it, consent as its basis, and also mutual economic support by the couple for each other and sexual fidelity have been very long-lasting, continuous features of marriage as we know it in the Western Christian tradition. But many other legal features of marriage have changed over time to keep up with changes in society at large. Within just the United States, in its relatively short history, marriage has been altered in very basic ways. In just the space of two centuries, marriage has really been, one might say, redefined. And it's been such a successful civil institution, in fact, because it has been flexible and not static. Now, when I say marriage has changed, and I'm going to describe two of the basic ways in which it has, when I say it has changed, it doesn't mean that these changes in marriage were always readily welcomed or that they were not difficult for some in society to accept. Indeed, many of the features we take for granted in marriage today, especially the ability of each spouse and both spouses, each to act as individuals, or for instance, the existence of a range of grounds for divorce, these things we take for granted, they were very much resisted when they were coming into being. Opponents saw these new features, if they were to happen, as destroying the institution fundamentally. But to persist for so long, the institution of marriage has had to be resilient. And in fact, it absorbed those seemingly very fundamental changes and survived. Now, the examples that I want to talk about of change are in the areas of racial regulation and the roles of the spouses. I could mention others, but my time, of course, is limited. I mentioned that slaves being deprived of all civil rights, including the capacity to consent, could not marry. Now, when masters allowed, slave couples did marry in form. It was really an informal, not state-supported marriage, but it was called marriage, and they often built long-lasting unions. But masters broke up those unions with impunity, and the slave marriage received none of that public vow I mentioned before. They received no support from governments. And very frequently, owners forced couples to break up because they wanted to sell one member or the whole master's family migrated, taking slaves with them. And this meant that slaves worked up patterns of informal marriage, serial monogamy, self-divorce. Then those patterns, which were generated by the inability to marriage, then generated stereotypes of African-American infidelity and promiscuity. So the very masters who prevented slave marriages then blamed slaves for having loose sexual behavior and justified the masters' attacks on sexual assaults on slave women. The question of marriage was very, very much alive in pro-slavery and anti-slavery discourse before the Civil War, because anti-slavery advocates who frequently decried slavery as a barbarous system saw much of its barbarism inhering in its destruction of the marriage bond. But after emancipation, former slaves could, for the first time, turn to governments to support their marriages. And at the end of the Civil War, the victorious Union government made a very positive effort to see that the emancipated slaves contracted legal marriages. The Freedmen's Bureau, which was the instrument of the Union government to settle the emancipated slaves, the Freedmen's Bureau took up this policy of trying to encourage and enforce legal marriage in the ex-slave population, because they, most of its members had absorbed the judgment of the anti-slavery camp that legal marriage was the best way to create productive, economically viable households among the emancipated freed persons. But the freed persons themselves had their own motivations for getting married legally. They saw marriage as an expression of their newly acquired civil rights, a vindication of themselves as free persons. They could consent, they were free individuals in the eyes of the law, they could enter into legal marriage, and their marriages deserved protection by the state from disruption by white overlords. So the ex-slaves tended to flock to get married. but they were still constrained in their choices of spouse in one important direction. That is, they could not, in most states, choose a white spouse. Because after emancipation, even more than before, or even more than the slavery period, many states had, several states newly passed or reinforced, laws that prohibited marriage between a white person and a person who was called a Negro or a mulatto. Now, these legal bars to marriage across the color line had actually existed since the 17th century colonies. The very first ones were in the Chesapeake colonies in the 1660s. So they had existed already for 200 years at the time of emancipation, despite the principle of freedom of choice in marriage. And this was not a set of prohibitions that existed only in the slave South. 41 states or territories had such a bar at some time in their history, and as more states were added to the United States and more diverse populations, a number up to 15 states also banned or voided or criminalized marriages between white persons and Chinese, Japanese, or Filipinos. Now, those designations were not usually used, rather more archaic racial designations such as Malay or Mongol were used in these laws, but the aim was to prevent marriages between white persons and persons of Asian birth or ancestry. Those kinds of state laws, these laws barring marriages across the color line, were justified on several grounds at the time, but they were usually said to enact at the civil law level what nature or God dictated, or they were said to be there to prevent a corruption of the institution of marriage. And the authorities who passed these laws considered it appropriate and defensible, even necessary, to place restrictions on marriages across the color line. Now, change in that regime of racial regulation through marriage didn't happen in any concentrated way until the middle of the 20th century, although there were ups and downs in it and has a complicated and interesting history. But in the post-World War II period, an increasing number of Americans came to see that these laws that restricted marital choice for what they were, that they were emblematic statements of white supremacy. I remark here that I don't use the phrase laws against interracial marriage, partly because, I mean, for one thing, because I think that term tends to reify what race is, but just as importantly, because these laws never prevented, for instance, a Chinese person from marrying an African American person. They never prevented a Malay from marrying a mulatto. These laws were only about the prevention of white persons marrying persons who were considered non-white. So because of this way in which these laws were emblems of advocacy of white supremacy, because also they were seen as antithetical to the concept that marriage should be based on free choice and consent, because they were seen as inconsistent with racial equality at the same time, certain enlightened parties started to think these laws should be eliminated. And California in 1948 was the first state to say that race-based restrictions on marriages were unconstitutional. The California Supreme Court then struck down law that had been part of its state's constitution and legal apparatus since 1851. And the California court in that case said, legislation on the right to marry, I quote, must be free from oppressive discrimination to comply with the constitutional requirements of due process and equal protection of the laws, end quote. The case was called Perez versus Sharp, and it sparked a lot of debate and the beginnings of an accelerated change in other states, but it took 20 more years till 1967 until the U.S. Supreme Court struck down all such state laws as against the due process and equal protection clauses of the 14th Amendment, and in a case that was very aptly named Loving versus Virginia. The couple's name who brought the case, their last name was Loving. That was 1967. And at that time, 15 American states still had such bars to marrying across the color line on their, enforced on their state books. Now, that was the end of essentially three centuries of a marital practice of using marriage law to enforce racial regulation. And it changed in 1967 to reflect society's evolving views of racial equality. And today, I think there's hardly anyone you could find, at least speaking publicly, who would question the legal right of individuals to marry others deemed racially different. Now, in the definition of spousal roles, I mean the role of husband and wife, the institution of marriage has changed as noticeably as on race. In Anglo-American practice, going back to the common law of early modern England, husband and wife were defined as having very different roles, roles that were complementary one to the other. The husband was seen as the independent partner and the economic provider, the wife as his dependent, whose service and labor the husband could command. Traditional marriage was based on a very central legal fiction, the legal fiction that the married couple was a single entity, that the couple together were one. This was called the doctrine of marital unity. And in that one, the husband was the legal, the economic, and the political representative of the unit that was the couple. Coverture was the formal name for this. It came from the Old French, which was imported into Anglo-American law. It stood for the woman being the femme covert, or the hidden woman, the woman who was covered by her husband's identity. And under this doctrine, the wife had no separate legal existence. This arrangement reflected society's view that the marital couple, since it was a unit, would naturally be headed by the husband. And this meant certain things, such as that a husband and a wife could not enter an enforceable contract between themselves once married. They were one person. It would be like making a contract with yourself, and that's clearly absurd. Under the oldest definitions of the coverture doctrine, a married woman could not even commit a crime. At any rate, she could not be prosecuted for a crime. She would be seen as under her husband's guidance, and he would be the responsible party, and he would be prosecuted for her wrongdoing, and certainly, and more typically, for any debt she incurred. This legal regime was, of course, also an economic regime. A married woman could not own or dispose of any property, earn money, or sue or be sued in her own name. She could only do these things through her husband. A wife's labor and any wages she earned belonged to her husband. He was also bound, similarly, he was bound to support her. That was his duty. And he had to support her because a wife could not even sign her own name to a document. She could never act as an individual in a marketplace. So she couldn't have an independent economic existence. Now, in the United States, this doctrine was imported within its law, but the notion that wives had no legal individuality and no economic maneuverability without a husband being right there and acting directly in sync, this notion began to clash with the realities of the developing society as early as the mid-1800s. So there was a mismatch because coverture defined the roles of wife and husband is absolutely different from one another, but in reality, the roles of wives and husbands tended to overlap. And wives began to demand the right to their own property and the right to the fruits of their own labor. Also, coverture had been designed to work in a more static rural economy. And in a dynamic market economy like that of the United States in the 19th century, husbands too saw advantages to the family as a corporate entity if their wives could hold property in their own names. Judges and legislators saw the advantages in a wife's holding separate property, this really as a means to keep ordinary families solvent when a creditor came after the husband's assets. If the wife had the house, let's say, in her own name, at least the family could retain the house while the creditor took all the husband's assets. And the government, the poor house, wouldn't have to think about what to do with his family that had just, whose house had just been taken by their creditors. So legislators and judges often saw savings for the public purse in married women being able to earn their own money to support their children if their husband ran away, if their husband was the victim of creditors. So the unity of the couple had been seen as absolutely basic to marriage, but courts and legislators saw fit to alter it. Besides the arguments for wives' individuality from an equal rights point of view, the arguments that we today might think were the most salient at the time, the economic arguments about families and how they really functioned were persuasive to the male legislators who actually passed the married women's property laws. So coverture, a doctrine and a practice that had for hundreds of years been seen as really essential to marriage, the whole concept of marital unity in the law was seen as the very basis of marriage. This doctrine, nonetheless, was eliminated gradually. It was a protracted process and took about 100 years, I would say, into the 1920s and 30s. And even in the 1970s, there were still some vestiges of coverture in the law, particularly in married women's inability to get credit cards on their own. But in the 1970s, in response to repeated challenges, courts and legislatures definitively dismantled coverture in favor of more equalitarian definition of marital roles. And one can see a striking statement of this in a case of 1971 that came before the Supreme Court. It was a case about birth control, but it happened to produce this statement that I find very, very emblematic. Because the court said in its opinion, I quote, "The marital couple is not an independent entity with a single mind and heart of its own, but an association of two individuals, each with a separate intellectual and emotional makeup," end quote. Now, in the past 30 years since that decision, the law's relation to marriage has continued to change, becoming generally less directive and prescriptive about the marital performance by the two spouses. Domestic relations law certainly no longer retains the fiction of marital unity. And also, just as important, the legal duties and responsibilities of the two spouses are defined in gender-neutral terms, not as specifically the obligations of the husband and specifically of the wife, but as the obligations of the spouses. This is really because of the women's rights revolution in the law in the 1970s. Also, marital rape and wife abuse used to be untouchable inside the marital household. Now these are crimes, prosecutable crimes. While sexual morality has become unchained from formal monogamy, and for instance, the old laws against fornication and adultery, while still on the books of many states, are generally ignored, the public does go inside a marriage to prosecute, for instance, marital rape. And in another major change from previous practice, which I don't have a chance to discuss, but divorce is in all the states something like no fault. That is, a divorce can be obtained simply by a couple saying that their marriage has reached a stage of irretrievable breakdown. And in courts, the families of cohabiting couples, unmarried couples, are treated like marital families. Parents' rights over and responsibilities for their children do not diminish in court because of birth out of wedlock. So these legal trends suggest that from that point of view, from the point of view of the law, the importance of marriage per se is withering. Yet in political rhetoric, as I was suggesting and as you must be aware, marriage has a renewed, perhaps an unprecedented prominence. And I'm thinking here, too, of initiatives such as legislation for covenant marriage in a number of states, state funding for marriage education for its population, the Bush administration's authorization of an unprecedented federal budget line for marriage courses among recipients of federal aid, and of course the move to have a constitutional amendment defining marriage added to the Constitution. This was first raised in 2004, the last election cycle. The national government's investment in heterosexual marriage has been very plainly emphasized, particularly in recent weeks. It's not only the recent weeks, though, of course. Many people in political life have been reading the trends that I mentioned at the outset, like the drop in proportion of adults currently married, the height of divorce rates, the height of births to unmarried parents, and the height of female-headed families as disaster signs for the polity. And what I want to emphasize here is that these are seen as political problems, that is, problems for the nation as a political association, not only problems for social life. The people who are very alarmed assume that the health of the American nation depends on monogamous, heterosexual, marriage-based families predominating. And this kind of affirmation of the indispensability of stable families based on monogamous heterosexual marriage might even be called a sort of civil religion in the United States. It has a very long tradition. Government policies throughout U.S. history have buttressed this form of marriage with great encouragements, encouraging people to see marriage as a preferred status. Today's particular policies take somewhat different form, but metaphors of the family as the linchpin of the state, the pillar of the polity, have been very common themes in American politics. But clearly, public authorities don't grant the same kind of imprimatur to every marriage. Couples who share the same sex see this very clearly. Massachusetts has led the nation in declaring equal marriage rights for all to be required by equal protection of the laws. Vermont has opened a new route by legalizing civil unions for same-sex couples. The New Jersey decision just recently followed the model of the decision made by the Vermont Supreme Court in 1999 when it made a similar pronouncement and directed its legislature to find a way to grant same-sex couples equal rights, and the civil union model was the result. But meanwhile, in reaction, at least 38 other states have passed laws limiting marriage to one man and one woman, and saying no other form of marriage will exist in their state. And most of these states have taken their cue from the Defense of Marriage Act, a federal statute which was passed very quickly and overwhelmingly 10 years ago by Congress when it appeared that Hawaii might license marriage for couples of the same sex. And in tune with these laws mandating marriage between one man and one woman, even Vermont's very valuable and comprehensive law for civil unions bows to opponents by, in its very first clause, reserving marriage to one man and one woman. And increasingly, states are incorporating a ban on same-sex marriage into their state constitutions rather than mere laws, which can be overturned by progressive courts. Many, like Kansas, have both passed a law and a constitutional amendment. I believe that Kansas was the 18th state to pass such a constitutional amendment. So these defensive actions show that the immense social, legal, and demographic changes of the last 30, 35 years have profoundly affected but have not yet unraveled the official insistence that heterosexual marriage is a necessary underpinning of the state. While alarmists tend to say that marriage is withering or on the wane, but one could equally argue that its value and prestige are more than ever boosted and believed in, even by those who do not partake themselves. There has been a kind of ironic convergence of conflicting advocacies here in boosting the status of marriage, that is, since the 1980s, in both the agenda of family values among conservative moralists and the advocacy on the part of same-sex couples have both converged on boosting the status of marriage. Now, marriage is, of course, preeminently a bundle of rights, benefits, and obligations, but it is more than that. The word marriage carries a meaning and a legitimacy that is attached to it through many years of validation by law and society. Part of that validation, of course, is simply that government has buttressed and privileged it so and relied on it. But I think this leaves us in 2006 with a question of whether we, that is we the public, should continue to reward that half, or I should say less than half, of the populace who are married. Who benefits from this attribution of value to those who are legally married? Who suffers from it? Do children, as advocates frequently say, benefit specially because of a legal bond between their parents? If one were to say no, what is the alternative to a benefit for marriage as such? Our society has come very far in the direction of attributing both rights and duties to the individual rather than to the corporate family or to the couple as a unit. Should we come even farther? The so-called marriage crisis that some would point to today, the withering or waning of marriage that I referred to, is a crisis that has been framed by conservative moralists, for the most part, who favor not only a privileging of the heterosexual family, but specifically the biological family. This kind of alarm that they've raised has drawn a lot of attention to the socioeconomic correlates of marriage. And it is true that social science investigations has shown that marriage, being married, is increasingly associated with people who are better off. One can frame this in a number of ways, can say that marriage is a class privilege, somebody might say, or you can just suggest that marriage is shown to be correlated with people who are doing better economically. Now, most of the social science literature on this tends to read that correlation as a causal connection moving in one direction, that is, that being married is seen as causing better socioeconomic status. What isn't so often queried, but I think deserves a lot more attention, is whether the direction of causation, if there is a causation, might move in the other direction. That is, those who are already situated better by reason of education, previous wealth, or outlook, that they have the wherewithal and the sense of self and empowerment to get married, as well as the resources to consider marriage. I think given the mass of questions that exist on these issues, which should be pressing to all of us as citizens, the challenge is to frame a democratic politics that supports marriage rights for all types without furthering the notion that a married couple is more worthy than a single person or than people involved in intimate relationships that are not marriages. The discussion about marriage shouldn't overwhelm a broader discussion about human rights and basic benefits that everyone needs, married or not. Thank you. I want to end there. you for your very fine attention. I would be happy to entertain comments or questions. I think I need a drink.
I wonder if I could ask a question myself whilst we're waiting. If I can, is the mic on? This is one of those horribly general big questions, but if you had to give a sort of a two-sentence description of the history of marriage, would it be...
They would be long sentences, that's what I would say.
Would it be something like like this? Now, the history of marriage is essentially a product of the tensions between the individual and the governmental sides of marriage. That the very paradox of the institution as you described it is actually what allows change and redefinition to take place.
Well, I think I might use the second sentence, but not exactly the first. That is, I think it is the way we've defined it, that it is something authorized by government, gives it this paradoxical quality that the state is always a party, and I think there is a tension between what individuals look for in that intimate relationship and what governments are looking for in social order. Yes, that's a truth, I think. Whether it's that has led to the particular changes, that would be harder to say, because I think most of the changes have their deeper causes tend to be economic and social change and the landscape of household organization as much as it is that intrinsic tension within the institution.
If I understand correctly, you're advocating an understanding of marriage wherein any people who will consent to this sort of marital relationship, however they may understand it, should be allowed by the law to engage in that kind of contract? Do you think that accurately? I want to make sure I understand you before I pose a question.
I'm not advocating anything. Okay. I was simply outlining the types of issues that are premises of marriage as we know it and some of the principles underlying those premises. Consent is certainly one, mm-hmm. And that originates actually in the Christian notion of marriage.
Okay. So within that framework, would the state have the power to limit, you know, relationships such as people who want to consent to polygamy or other relationships that we might generally agree are inappropriate or unhealthy? I'm wondering how that might fit into the framework you're laying out.
Well, as I said, first of all, I'm not advocating mm-hmm. a program here. But in saying that consent between two parties has mm-hmm. been basic to marriage as we know it, I'm not suggesting that consent is a sufficient basis okay. for marriage.
Okay, so there are still...
So I think you're going way beyond what I was suggesting.
Okay, I just wanted to see how you would flesh that out. Thank you.
In fact, one of the things that's interesting, though, if you look at the history of the way the system of marriage that we're accustomed to has been defended in the 17th, 18th, 19th century, it was most often distinguished by its advocates who were Christian Protestants, at least in the American tradition, was distinguishing it from polygamy. And their advocacy associated consent only with the monogamous form. They assumed that polygamy had to be a form based on coercion and despotism, mainly because they could not envision that any woman would willingly consent to marry a man who already had a wife or wives. So that in the Western tradition that we're heir to, the association of polygamy with the opposite of consent is very much part of that tradition.
Do you see any comparisons to the way that, you know, people talk about marriage has traditionally been heterosexual and, you know, defining our Western tradition and even in other cultures as well as a way of understanding marriage as only heterosexual, therefore excluding homosexual unions as having the status of marriage?
Well, I think a lot of half-truths or non-truths are thrown around under the guise of this is what traditional marriage is, mm-hmm. in that there are many traditions of marriage in many different cultures. Mm-hmm. And we do inherit a particular tradition, which I was trying to describe, the monogamous heterosexual lifelong marriage tradition. But certainly what I would say is that worldwide we see heterosexual couples forming unions, having babies, whether they do that inside an authorized form of marriage or not, or say a polygamous form of marriage. That's clearly true, but that's not saying very much in terms of how cultures organize their governance in their households.
Okay, thank you.
Working?
I was thinking, you have presented a very interesting perspective on how marriage, how changes in society eventually are affecting and altering marriage as an institution and how it's changing. But I was wondering whether it could also have been seen the other way around, how marriage relations and sort of the way marriage is understood in a given moment sort of has an impact in sort of the other institutions such as politics, economics. You know, that's the way I saw it for 17th and 18th century Europe. But I've never wondered myself whether this can be carried on to the present moment. So whether like politics and economics particularly are learning from or imitating or sort of like learning something from marriage relationships.
Mm-hmm. Well, I do think in the Western tradition, as I'm sure you're aware, there in the regime of monarchy, certainly there were continual familial metaphors drawn that linked in parallel the marital household and the state, the household of the state, that the king is to his subjects as the husband is to his dependents and his family. So that I think that kind of parallel has always been very active. And there I could cite examples, say, from the period of the American Revolution, where the revolutionaries looked to consent in marriage as a model, they said, for what they saw as the consent basis of their union among the previous colonies that would form the United States. But I think it would be a stretch to say that marriage was having an impact on the form of government. Rather, it was a handy reference that everyone knew about and that could be drawn on and as much of it taken as was useful for the purposes of an advocacy. So I think it's a dynamic relationship, but it exists at a fairly general and in a fairly general way that I'd be hard put to find an example where I think the form of marriage actually changed the form of government.
Well, we'll need to wait until Bush quotes like gay marriage for, you know, to explain some like, you know, state policies or something.
But I do think it's not a trivial exercise though to see how marriage and government are usually by most states or government seems it's necessary to see them as allied, which is exactly why I was saying to the previous questioner that this distinction of Western marriage and its alliance with consent as compared to what was seen as the Eastern harem and despotism and tyranny was a very important axis of distinction of the Western constitutional monarchies in during the Enlightenment, for instance.
I am married. And every April we have a discussion when we sit down to do our taxes and we're married and filed jointly, and it always is head of household. We have this big discussion about who is the head of household, much to the chagrin of our accountant, who is just trying to get the darn mm-hmm. taxes done while we're having mm-hmm. this big philosophical discussion. What other relics of the concept of the one-party marriage are still formally entrenched in our government that I haven't thought about so I can be appropriately annoyed?
I don't know. That's a good one. It There probably is terminology. Certainly things in, say, Social Security are still written that way, but they're gender neutral, just like head of household is. And in fact, I think these days it's totally optional whether a husband or a wife puts himself or herself as head of household. But it is a residue, you're right, certainly. I thought you were going to ask me about the so-called marriage penalty in the income tax law. I mean, it's actually a very interesting subject, how that got there, because it's a marriage benefit, of course, not only penalty.
A couple of the changes you mentioned, one was the end of racial regulation, the other the end of couverture, and obviously there are very many reasons why that took place. Can you see reasons developing at the moment for a change which would allow gay marriage to come in, which is obviously seen as deeply threatening at the moment, but then so was racial regulation when that was ended? Mm-hmm. Can you see any build-up of factors that would lead to gay marriage coming into the sanctity of marriage or the civic?
Well, I think that there are a number of factors that have made it possible. It is in fact, the law in Massachusetts, and so something must have happened there. And I think there are a number of factors. One is simply the way we have extended the notion of equal rights, and the fact that when you look literally at U.S. law, at words like equal protection of the laws, words like choice, consent, marriage as a fundamental right. It seems hard to deny that right to people just because they want to marry someone of the same sex. And in fact, the question was framed in one of the earlier state cases. I think it was the Alaska case sometime in the mid-90s, but I could be misremembering, where the judge said, the question is not whether marriage to a member of the same sex is a fundamental part of our law, but whether the equal choice of marriage partner is part of our fundamental law. So I think that the rights tradition, the robustness of the individual rights tradition and equal protection tradition as it's been developed since the 1970s is very important, as is the tremendous, just socially, tremendous change in sexual mores and the degree to which gays and lesbians are accepted. This is generally commented on in all of the public press that talks about the drawing the line in the sand around marriage per se. So I think a number of things have converged, and the one thing legally that's been extremely important is the decision in Lawrence v. Texas, the decision that made it that overthrew the Texas law that had criminalized sodomy that was in private in a consensual relationship. This decision, I'm proud to say, relied a great deal on a historian's brief. And it was a brief I signed, but I can't claim the real authorship, which belongs to George Chauncey, who's a historian who's just recently moved to Yale from University of Chicago. And he argued persuasively, because it's true, that laws that create, in effect, a second-class citizenship for individuals because they practice gay sex were not something that had a long tradition. There were certainly long ago, back to 1600 or so, criminalization of acts. Certain sexual acts like sodomy. But the sexual act of sodomy is criminalized for whether two men committed it or whether a man and a woman committed it. It was not a law that singled out a person for a particular kind of behavior. But through the 20th century, since sodomy laws in the states were not enforced in private behavior by heterosexual couples, these laws and other intersections between law and practice have tended to, and the court accepted this reasoning, singled out homosexuals as a separate class of citizen because of their sexual behavior, and it's given them, in effect, a second-class status as citizens. And it was that argument for the action of the law that Justice Kennedy adopted in his decision in Lawrence v. Texas. And I think that this question of second-class citizenship is the one that will, legally anyway, be the driving force to enable marriage to be extended to couples of the same sex. I actually see it as legally having a great deal of analogy, parallel, it's not an analogy, it's more stricter than that, to the laws that prohibited marriage across the color line, in that those marriages were defended legally in the late 19th century as not discriminatory because they equally affected whites and blacks, or whites and Asians, who could not marry one another. However, when the Supreme Court in Loving Virginia struck these laws down, they said that even though the ostensible operation of the law was symmetrical, they acted as a form of white supremacy maintenance in creating a second-class citizenship for blacks, who were the only people forbidden from marrying whites, or Asians as the only people forbidden. And same-sex couples have been pursuing this in their advocacy, that these marriage prohibitions do create a second-class citizenship, a second-class set of rights for couples who want to marry. So that's what I would project.
As historians ever have that moment of relevancy in the courtroom and so on.
I know, it's been a great surprise to me.
Do you have any observations on the entire process? Or?
Well, I have had some thoughts on that. I think that one of the dangers for someone like me, who certainly did not write my book as an advocate, although I was influenced to see the question of the relation between marriage and the government as a question of interest by couples who were advocating opening marriage rights to members of the same sex. It's what put the spotlight for me on the fact that marriage has this public side, the side of state sanction that is so crucial, but that most people, until the last 15 or 20 years, just wouldn't think about. They think about, should I get married, or should I live with my boyfriend? And they don't think, oh, the state is involved, you know. But this forced me to realize that was a very important part of the history of marriage, and yet the side that was not discussed, which is why I thought I ought to look into its history. But I've been involved in a number of historians' briefs, just writing up, really, the fact that marriage has been a changing institution, that it is a civic institution, that it's legislators who have the power to change it, that, in fact, the way marriage has always been practiced and enforced in the United States, it hasn't been God who's done the work of enforcing it. It's been the state. But I think in the process, the arguments of lawyers and advocates are to say marriage has always been getting better and freer and better and freer, and more about individuals and more about their freedoms and less about its status as a governance institution. And I think that on balance, I would want to maintain that marriage is an institution of governance. It's what it originated as, and it still very much functions that way. And this, too, might be a reason why of same-sex marriage would come into being, because it does tend to enforce certain duties and obligations on people. It does help the state and public authorities get off the hook for providing benefits to people because they have a spouse or a partner who is obligated to provide for them. So that's one thing that has come up for me, that the advocacy may lead you to stress certain things and understress others that seem like the essential thing for the purpose at hand. Any other comments?
Bob?
Bob?
At the beginning, you spoke of all kinds of changes that are going on that have brought married people to a minority within the population as a whole. It seems to me there are a number of things that are related to that that have to do with family. And you maybe don't want to go off the whole different topic here, but it seems to me there are some connections, and I wonder if you've done much with this. These changes that are happening so far as marriage is concerned in the whole adult population, there's also a lot of change that's going on in what we understand the family to be. And then the state tries to keep up then with who is going to be responsible for, and we've got so many states now trying to get their laws improved to try to make sure that that male father of child pays the bills. Is there just a whole big mess going on here in our trying to figure out what is it that ties people together, including adults who have children?
Well, I think unquestionably there is a lot of concern about it, and it's a reason that so many state governments, as well as the federal government, have put in budget lines for marriage education and parenthood education. Yes. I think that these questions of what marriage is and what the family is are, of course, inherently tied, most definitely. Yeah, I was just reading a social science report which put it very tersely that while more and more people are delaying marriage, if not just opting out altogether, they are not delaying parenthood. And that's a part of the issue we face. But there are very, very interesting things about comparisons across country and so on, because, well, I think most Americans have a prejudice about cohabiting couples being less reliable than marital couples. If you look at cohabiting couples in the U.S. as compared to cohabiting couples in Europe, far, far more cohabiting couples in Europe stay together than they do in the U.S. So that right now, the projection is that if things continue as they are, in Southern Europe, within a few years, about three-quarters of 15-year-olds will be living with their biological parents at the age 15. And in Northern Europe, about two-thirds of 15-year-olds. But in the U.S., only half of 15-year-olds will be living with their two biological parents. And given that there are many trends militating against formal marriage, I sometimes wonder if our tremendous prejudices in this country against cohabiting couples or non-marital households in general are not, on the whole, rather disadvantageous to us as a nation and society as a whole, in that the move toward non-marriage in Europe has happened, if anything, even more dramatically than here, yet it hasn't meant as widespread a phenomenon of disrupted households and children living in households that do not hold their biological parents, because the burdens that marriage used to assume have simply shifted to non-marital households. And here, that's been much more troubling, that transition. So it may be that giving marriage all the privilege is not, for the society as a whole, the most constructive strategy.
Example, I'm a French historian and happened to do research in the Second World War period where, as you probably know, the government of France at the time adopted a credo, a famille, travail, patrie, the family, work, and labor. What did I say? Famille, travail, patrie, and country. But it was the linking of a family and the same kind of interpretation of marriage with country that was a sort of fleeting moment in French history and not a very good one in many ways. when the government adopted that and promoted that very strongly as a credo, which happened to replace liberty, equality, fraternity, which in terms of your free choice was an interesting sort of phenomenon as well. But what I'm curious about in the American case is it seems to me in my lifetime that what's happening right now in terms of the politicization of the issue seems unprecedented. Maybe I'm just feeling like I've lived a long time and I don't remember anything like this. And I just wondered, from your perspective and of all of U.S. history, is this really extraordinary, or have we had other moments where, like in France during the war, it was actually put right on the front burner as this is what, you know, this is the basis of our society, and it was the national government saying that. It seems extraordinary to me what's happening now.
Well, I think so too, but it's hard to measure in any exact way, in that it is certainly true that the family model as the thing that is said to be the common denominator for American society has been a recurrent theme. And even you might even look at the fact that since the founding of the U.S. as the first republic in the world, that a focus on the presidential couple was important from the start, and that was not really typical. I mean, you could say that, well, there was more of a royal analogy there, and the queen as well as the king was always important. But it is really striking, I think, that this touchstone of the family has been resorted to within our political rhetoric for such a long time. And I tend to attribute it to the absence of a national religion, and that families were seen as a convenient political symbol of something that represented what everyone participated in and was a common referent for everyone. So it's hard to measure whether at certain points in time there's a particular alarm. There have been many, many alarms about marriage in many periods of time, including, say, immediately after the Civil War. There was a huge alarm because the divorce rate seemed to be going up. Many churchmen thought marriage was just going to be dissolved altogether. And then similarly, around the turn of the century, during World War II, there was a huge hue and cry about latchkey children because so many women were doing war work, and about juvenile delinquency in the 50s. And so historians of the family and of social life can talk about all of these different periods, and I don't know whether our particular alarmism in this period ought to be seen as really unprecedented in its height. But I do think that these specific moves to use government to solve the problem, or to address the problem, let's say, in a very direct way by counseling people in their marriages, that or prescribing courses, that's unusual. Not just the counseling, though. It is true that under the New Deal in the 1930s, when a lot of government money went into all sorts of new agencies, that was really what first injected life into the marriage counseling movement, because social work got a great deal of money from New Deal agencies, and marriage counseling was just coming into its own in that period.
So one final question?
Yes, to return to the kind of European-American comparison, and maybe this is obvious, but since Europe has moved to the governance, let's say the economic governance and well-being of the citizens on an individual basis rather than through the marital model, isn't this in large part explain why for example, cohabitation is well accepted in Europe, much more so.
And it's more viable economically.
Maybe it's economic factors and huge economic interests in this country that are so closely tied and have been for decades to the way we govern families, marriage, cohabitation or not, that's behind it. I mean, just think what would happen in the United States if, for example, healthcare changed so that you know, you didn't have to provide healthcare for your children because you were married, but on an individual basis. I mean, that to me, it seems like the economic factors are what really define differences in European attitudes and American attitudes. Those are the only two models I happen to know. Vis-a-vis, you know, this marriage question and the problem of accepting or not accepting same-sex marriage or civil unions.
Well, I tend to think that the line of argument you just outlined it must be right. I don't have enough information to really make the argument, but I definitely think that has a lot to do with it. Yeah, that the channeling of economic benefits to individuals enables them to make marriage choices and have a more viable lifestyle. Yes.
Join us for the reception opposite.
Thanks very much.